Welcome to Stew and The Nunn, an online show and podcast focused on national security, policy, politics, and self-service. We are here to give you an honest opinion, a different perspective, and hopefully a few laughs. We do this by not only interviewing guests, but also sharing our own perspectives and asking you, the listener, to interact with us on our show chat room, via our Facebook page, and on Twitter. All right, welcome everyone to another episode of Stew and the Nunn. Here it is, April 15th, would be known as Tax Day, but not this year, kind of like last year. We're on a trend here. And as you see, I am joined by my very, very longtime good friend who just reminded me earlier, it's been like 29 years, and co-host, guest, and sponsor of the show, Doug Mullen from Gear for Grunts. What's up, Doug? How you doing, brother?
Hey, it's just great to be here. How you doing, Mr. Troy? How's everything up north?
Good. You know, you're down there in the Southern Studio alternate supplemental location, not in Georgetown.
Like the Jump Talk.
You're in the Jump Talk. That's right. You're over a little bit. Our good buddy Toby, the Nunn, can't make it tonight, but you have so graciously stepped in, as you've done many times, to fill the gap. And I want to see our chat room piping up there and filling in. But, yeah, glad you could join us. How's the weather down there? I got to look at what our weather is here.
It was, you know, it's 63 degrees right now, so it's almost like a winter day here compared to y'all. You know, so it's like you have to wear, like, a vest or something.
I saw you had snow today.
Yeah, they almost, like, canceled school because it's almost so cold. And I'm actually looking out the window right now. It's rainy and dark, and we just skirted where I am, kind of in northwest Austin, a line of hailstorms that went and pummeled, you know, points north of here, like Round Rock, Leander, and probably Georgetown.
Any tornadoes hitting the ground there? Or
There's been no tornado warnings yet, but a lot of the roofing guys and the car damage guys, they're like, woohoo, because it's just about this time of year is how they make probably 80% of their money.
Well, I think the tornadoes tried to hit Nolanville, Harker Heights, and areas around Fort Hood, if I remember right, at least when I lived there.
Yeah, they got hammered too. Yeah, sorry, I forgot about the Copper's Cove type as well. So the great place up there.
That's right, the Hood, the hot life in the Hood there. But, well, good. Yeah, it's a 40 degrees here in western New York. Overcast. Man. Yeah, so not too bad. We're done with all the snow, I think. I actually mowed my grass the other day for the first time, so I think it's that time of year. But, yeah, good to see you, and good to see everyone else coming online. I see it. I want to make sure I highlight our sponsors. You know, Veteran Outdoors, obviously, you know, Toby's very instrumental in leading that organization. Big sponsor of ours, along with Kermode Outdoor Development Group. Makers of fine apparel and fishing industry and just outdoor apparel. Enlisted 9 Fight Company. Rolling my Enlisted 9 here tonight, and boohammer.com, and of course Gear for Grunts. So I want to give you a quick second before we bring our guests on, Doug. Gear for Grunts has been known for a while with the ramp device that they've had out for a while.
You mean this? The ramp device.
So
but don't leave home without it.
Yeah, that's right. Never leave home. Not that I would have any because I live in New York, but yeah.
Yeah, you can't. This is probably illegal up there, north of the Mason-Dixon line, probably, right?
Just in the home state of Adolph Como, it probably is. But however, Gear for Grunts has moved into some new product line, and it's kind of related to our guest tonight, who is also in this product business at once.
I'm going to have to talk to him about this. But, yeah, to your point, so I literally, the brand new, it's up on the website, Spotlight Ranger shirt. You know, it's because they're all about limited engagement and select performances only. So it could be, and what's great about this shirt is, Troy, everyone, it's not just like a Ranger school necessary type term. Maybe it's spawned from there, but it's applicable it's applicable to all point. You know, everybody knows a spotlight teacher, spotlight news anchor, spotlight whatever. You just insert the noun.
Is it used outside the military? I mean, obviously, I know it's used in the military. Do you think it has appeal outside the military?
I use it on my civilian job when someone is filling that role because people are people, right? And, you know, so maybe, you know, again, it was the sad thing is, Troy, it happens so often that we have a term for it. And most people know what it is, right? Without really telling them.
And sadly, from the days when you humped Dahlonega and the mountain and the desert phase and the jungle phase, you know, there's a lot more people now that try to spotlight themselves thanks to social media. And right, if anything, this country has turned into a country of spotlight rangers that want their 15 minutes of viralness.
See? Right. See, it's even, thank you. It makes it even more applicable. And on the back, I have a quote from Mr. Neil Peart from the Rush song Limelight from 1981. All the world's merely a stage and we are merely players, performers and portrayers, to your point. It's exactly what it's about. And wait. And I have the coveted Old Glory with, even if you're a spotlight ranger, rangers still lead the way.
There we go.
So like, I like to describe myself as I am to Ranger School what Bob Uecker is to Major League Baseball. That's me. That guy.
All right. So there we go. You heard it here first.
Not a best Ranger.
And Rob is
happy to be here.
Rob is putting it up. There's apparently it's in Urban Dictionary, so now everyone knows about it.
See?
So he put it up there.
See, now it's on the internet. It's real, right?
Yeah, that's it.
It's the truth.
And I almost forgot Alpha Elite Performance. Thanks, Rob, putting that up. Alpha Elite, great makers of supplement products, all veteran-owned, veteran-run. We've had Travis on here a number of times. I had mine this morning before I went to the gym, so don't want to oversee them. We just don't have their logo up yet. So with that being said, I definitely want to get into bringing our guest on, Mr. Jason Beardsley. A phenomenal man, retired Special Forces Master Sergeant, so he's near and dear to my heart because he wore the green beanie and he's a senior NCO. He's done a lot of things, never stopped giving and serving our country, always continued to give back, and with that, I am doing my technical stuff here and bringing him on. Jason, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, and really honored to be here with you, Troy, and you, Doug, as well. And since you brought it up, Doug, we ought to just raise a glass to the late, great Neil Peart.
Oh. Hey, amen, brother. Yeah. I've been a fan since my older brother brought home the 2112 album in the year of our Lord, 1976. So real quick, so I was like in the second grade. So we were in the Kiss phase right then, because that's when Destroyer came out and stuff. So we immediately, when you brought that home, it's like, wow, this is, I don't know anything. I'm just a little kid, but this is markedly better than Kiss or Ted Nugent. And then I've just been in the Rush phase ever since. So awesome, excellent.
Yes.
Thanks for that.
And I appreciate anybody putting out great work. So yeah, here's to them.
Yeah, Jason. Just so you know, Doug is also the. If you're ever in a cash cab or in any game show, and need to phone a friend. If it has to do with 80s music. And I mean anything with 80s music. This dude absolutely knows every, like, he'll send me a quote from a song and be like, what album, what side was that on? And I mean, I can throw him one. Yeah. And he'll be like, that was, you know, that was Nick Gilder in 1982.
Hot Child in the City, 1979.
That's it.
Wow.
There you go. Right.
Yeah. So maybe you're more the Bob Uecker of like 80s genre and nostalgia.
Exactly. You just do Bob Uecker and just do exactly. Not just for other military related things, but for pop culture that you didn't know you needed to know. I'm here to help you with that.
Yeah, that's it.
So
and love it. And he's not follically challenged like some of us either. So
hey, again, just happy to be here.
Just, I got you.
You know, I'm blade running, Troy, because if you know, my late father and my late grandfather on my mother's side, it's amazing. I even have eyebrows at this point. I'm just totally beating all the odds. So,
well, your son may not be so lucky. That may skip generations. So, Junior, maybe.
I know. Hey, man, I told him you better get taking a look into that now before it's too late.
That's it. But yeah, so Jason, again, welcome to the show. You've quite a storied career, as I kind of talked about, and hopefully in these first couple minutes, you kind of got a temperature of how this show rolls, but and you're good with it. But would you mind? We got a lot of listeners and viewers tuning in. Kind of give them a little bit of your background, of your military career, and anything else you think is is you want to highlight that will kind of lead to probably some of the points we're talking about.
Oh, sure. Yeah, I appreciate it. You know, it's pretty linear, but non-traditional. Always wanted to be in the military, and found myself hunting sort of the higher tier organizations. Went into the Navy to be a SEAL, like many back in 1990. Put some time down in Buds, but didn't make the program. I was injured, went to the fleet. That's everybody's story, so I know everybody's rolling their eyes. No, so got to the fleet, did the Persian Gulf. Enjoyed some time sailing the seven seas and the wondrous adventures that they had, but I wasn't quite satisfied. So went over to the Army Green Berets and started training in 96 and throughout the course and different schools, language school, airborne, all that stuff, fell in love, found the home for wayward children. That's probably the only place in the military I could actually make it, special operations. And so, we went through 9/11, of course, everything amplified from there. That put a lot of us in the on the road back and forth to the Middle East. I did some contracting in that time as well, so floated around a couple of the departments and agencies and came back with a hunger to kind of go a little bit further into training, and went through another selection process and some continued special operations advancements in my career. Found myself in a really wonderful place for about 10 years. Doing operations that were really pushing the edges of kind of second and third ridgeline type battlefields, if you will. And I think I kind of got the full ride in my career. You know, everything I wanted as a young boy, I got to do as an old guy. And jumping out of planes, blowing things up, driving boats, shooting, you know, moving and communicating. And I really enjoyed that. Had the opportunity to kind of get to that place in a career where the little boy inside you that just wants to crawl around in the bushes with your buddies and get dirty with guns finds himself briefing PowerPoints and standing up in embassies and wearing suit and tie. And you see right at the edge of, let's call it policy, where policy meets tactics, or where strategy meets tactics. And that gets into the political. Once that happened, felt like I did everything I wanted in my career, retired in 2013. And thought, what's the next hardest thing I can do to stay on an upward learning curve? And started small business, a retail op. So close to your heart there, Doug. And we spent some time developing great products that express the American experience for guys and girls out there today that want to be proud of who they are. And then in the last few years, because of my advocacy with veterans and veteran issues, I was asked to come into the Department of VA, advising the secretary at the time, and working with the veteran service organizations. And from there, I went over to Department of Defense to handle some business at the Special Operations Low Intensity Conflict Office. And recently came out of that experience to land where I am now, which is at the helm of the Association of the United States Navy. So that's the full sort of picture in a quick nutshell.
Well, that's definitely, you definitely hit on it there. Yeah. So you sound like you spent some time in groups and then you moved on to some other special areas. I mean, not going to guess and don't have to divulge if you didn't, but it sounded kind of asymmetric warfare groupish type that you were doing some cutting edge kind of extra stuff. But were you a fifth group or a third group guy the whole time or?
No, appreciate that. I started as a 19th group guy, which gave me the opportunity to do those contract routes in between deployments. So you're kind of getting it on as a civilian, but then also as a military guy. And then I launched into full active duty to go into some of that asymmetric stuff. It wasn't AWG. I have some great friends that went there, but you know, a lot of things happened after 9/11 to kind of put us in a very different disposition downrange. So full ride.
Absolutely. And no, very interesting and great career. I mean, you've done a lot and, you know, just what you could divulge. I mean, it was quite a bit in a storied career. And I didn't even realize you had started in the Navy.
Right.
Which will lead. I guess I know now why you are where you're at. I was wondering, how did an SF guy end up where you are now? But I guess, did that have some tie into it or kind of just
in a very direct way, but also, you know, during my role with the secretary at the VA, I had the opportunity to meet a lot of the gentlemen and ladies working in the veteran service organization space and built some trust there. And that kind of floated over. Organizations like AUSN really do need great leadership. And sometimes that requires sort of operational mindset, the senior enlisted mindset that comes along with sort of executing operations at the tactical level over and over again. So they were in a place where it was time for them to kind of go back and do some, let's call it a reassessment of where they were, and then look at how to grow forward. I happened to fit the bill. They gave me their trust. I came in and looked at what the AUSN was doing to really carry the voice of the U.S. service members, naval service. So that's sailors, that's Marines, that's Coast Guard, but really it includes everyone, and carry that voice into Washington, D.C. I happen to know it from the other side of the coin, and so it made a really good fit.
Yeah, yeah. Is it? I'm assuming it's like the sister organization of AUSA, right? The Association of the United States Army. It carries the same, does it carry the same kind of mission and have the same kind of charter, if you would?
At certain levels, right, they have similar goals, but AUSA, frankly, has done a phenomenal job at building a unique business model in this space. They're very large, and they have a very deliberate, defined presence. They've got the top flight sort of gala in Washington, D.C., and they've done a fantastic job with that. So every veteran service organization kind of does a little bit of a different space or owns a market space. And so it's up to the veteran service organization, the VSO, to really kind of define for its members, how do we care about your voice? And what we're going to have to do in AUSN is a little bit different because, frankly, there are business systems underneath AUSA that have really fueled some of their progress where they are now. We're a different organization, but at the end, both sort of stand up for veterans inside D.C. Not easy to do, by the way.
No, I'm sure not. Well, doing anything in D.C. is not easy if you're not of the aligned with the majority there. And regardless of who's in office, I would say that the majority doesn't always align with whoever's in office and who the administration is,
right,
as you've seen firsthand. Go ahead, Doug.
I was just going to say real quick, Jason, do you foresee what you just said, you know, advocating for veterans? As tough as it is on a good day, do you anticipate that potentially that hill becoming a little bit steeper as we go forward here in the next several years?
Yeah, but for a lot of reasons that are maybe complex, I'll just state, you know, the two principles to me up front are combat effectiveness or combat readiness and morale. Those two are real foundational concepts for veterans. And morale happens in a lot of places, whether it's at the Department of VA on the backside when Veterans Affairs is taking care of the veteran, or it happens on the front side, how do we recruit, or somewhere in the middle, how do we retain? And all those things from recruit to retention to sort of care on the backside are really vital pillars to keeping the service members prepared and ready for combat. That's difficult now for a lot of reasons. We've been 20 years or so at war. We've stressed our systems. We've burned into the part of the population that is kind of less than the 2%, I believe, now in service. And so we don't have the same connectivity we did in places like World War II. So number one, that makes it difficult. Number two, as the culture sort of changes and grows, the military is downstream from culture. And some of those cultural changes impacting the military create challenges, right? Whether you like them or don't like them, one of the big challenges is how do you maintain morale on an upward glide slope? So yes, I think it's going to be more challenging. And particularly as we're at the end of these 20 years or potentially seeing another 10 in front of us, and we haven't defined a clear path ahead. That's one of our big watchwords is what we want from leadership is clarity and vision.
No, that's good stuff.
Yeah, that makes sense. See, I mean, you've with what you've done with the State Department, with missions overseas and you know, firsthand threats that you have faced. I mean, seeing what the horrors of the battlefield and everything like that, and then coming back and seeing what's happening in, you know, in our own capital and has been happening for our own capital for the last couple of months. You know, the barbed wire, the fencing and all that stuff. What's your gut feeling on it to see our nation's capital, the most freest and powerful country in the world, to be wrapped in the layers of security that we've seen it in the last couple of months?
Yeah, I mean, it, for me, that's maybe it's almost the antithesis of who I think we are. The presidents early on, when they set up the Capitol, were very open about welcoming the people. This is the people's house. Even Capitol Hill, it's really ruled by the consent of the governed. And so I think we really want to strike the right balance between bringing people into our governance and keeping that arm's length. And the more we work to kind of keep people at arm's length, the harder it is to really assess, really understand and draw from the governed how it is they feel. Now, with that, you know, we're all military guys. We know there are security protocols and there are threats and there are things we have to be watchful for. But I think that's the balance, and it's a challenge. And I can appreciate that it's a difficult challenge for senior leaders in DOD, senior leaders on Capitol Hill, the presidents. But it's a challenge that we need to be careful about, because once we move that needle, or once we move that sort of that line, if you will, it's harder and harder to get it back. The liberties of the American citizen are why the government was instituted. It's to protect those. So every time we have to kind of encroach on those, we need to do that with very deliberate, careful sort of measure.
Do you think they're going to keep it there long enough for people to get used to it? When I say that, I think about how the fence line in front of the White House was not that long ago, was not out to where it is now, right? The ellipse was open. You could walk along the ellipse. You could do that kind of stuff. You know, Pennsylvania Avenue wasn't so closed down. And, you know, but obviously through some threats years past, they pushed that barricade out. People got used to it and said, that's just the way it is. Do you think people make it used to looking at our capital like we've spent years looking at Kabul and Baghdad, of how their own capitals were just wrapped in wire and Jersey barriers and HESCOs?
Hey, Troy, that's a really good point. And I think that, you know, the answer is a little complex, but we saw it after 9/11 with flying right at the airport. And, you know, it was a different world before 9/11. Collectively as a society, we made these sort of decisions and allowed for the furtherance of security, the security mindset of the state, and we compromised some of our liberties. And as you suggest, when we do that with sort of frequency, or when we do it a little bit casually, those systems tend to get more increased rather than decreased. And I'm afraid to say that, unfortunately, we see that as more common, more habitual, that once a security measure is in place, it's very difficult to walk it back. And then it's incumbent upon the leadership to explain why you're walking it back. Can you imagine right now, if somebody came in and recommended doing away with TSA, it would be a pretty phenomenal sort of recommendation in comparison to what we're seeing. So you make a great point. In order for us not to get used to that, our voice has to be carried into the leadership, and it's got to be carried frequently, and it's got to be amplified by organizations like mine, entertainment podcast, news podcast, news outlets and media. All of them should be carrying the voice of the American people back into DC. And frankly, we just want to see more of that. We want to see it all over, because if their voice is heard, if the people's voice is heard, our leaders will tend to make the right decisions, but they'll get away with exactly what we let them get away with.
Yeah, I'm gonna jump in. I'm gonna play both devil's advocate on this one, because something you said just triggered some thoughts. One, just a week or so ago, we had a mentally disturbed young man kill a Capitol Police officer. Right, ran his car, ran into him, got out with a big knife, and stabbed another officer. And you know, right after that point, when you know the crime scene wasn't even done being processed, people were still being evacuated. Many in the news media were already saying, "Look, aren't you? We should. Isn't it a good thing we had these roadblocks in place left over from January 6th? And isn't it a good thing we had all this? Because imagine if we didn't, that guy could have drove right up to the front steps of the Capitol, which you could always have done to a degree, or much closer. You know, they show that, you know, a couple of National Guard soldiers, you know, a couple dozen of them running over like they were the SWAT team on Blues Brothers, you know, hut hut hutting their way down Constitution Avenue forming a barricade." And the media immediately jumped on it and was saying, isn't it a good thing we have all these in place? Because this guy could have got that much closer and stuff. I look at that and it makes me think, okay, the media, they're using this narrative to say, you know, hey, this is a good thing. We should keep all this in place. And then I look at the other flip side of the coin. When we talk about, you mentioned, you know, we put these security measures in place and it'd be hard for someone to roll them back, and leadership to roll them back. Then I look at the southern border. And I look at a security measures depth and defense, many systems put in place over the last 4 years to help secure the southern border. And all of that got removed pretty much with a stroke of a pen. So I'm not saying you're wrong. I'm just saying I look at approach. It's almost like it really doesn't matter what the people say, and they really don't listen to it. It's kind of like almost like leadership is doing what they want to do, regardless of what maybe the popular opinion is. Just get your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, it's also that's a well-stated counterpoint. And I think what it really means is, again, if the voice of the people doesn't carry a threat inside the beltway, right, inside the DC beltway, again, the leadership will get away with whatever they can. And so that voice has to resonate. And so whether it's the border, fencing around the Capitol, or TSA, if the people are animated, there's a price politicians pay for going against the people. And if we can't compel that price, then you're absolutely right. The people will be kind of not quite steamrolled, but their voice will not be welcomed if it's not enforced, right? And so, again, in an environment where it's harder to get the voice of the people inside these leadership sort of dialogues, it's very important for outlets like yours to be alive, to be thriving. Sometimes you're going to cater to a voice that others won't, or someone on the other end of the spectrum is going to cater to others. But that's the point, is they really need to, there needs to be the both polar opposite ends speaking to leadership constantly. And we've got to make those threats real at the ballot box. That's the only way.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting. It's almost like they're trying to normalize that, right? You know, troop uniformed troops around, you know, certain places. Because I remember you said 911. I mean, I remember traveling, you know, took our family to Disney World like early November of 01, just a couple months later. And I remember the National Guardsmen walking around with empty M16s and, you know, Austin Airport and in Orlando. And so it was fine with me. I was like, oh, these dudes I don't even know if these dudes even have ammo, you know? So, but it's almost like the same people who were, I think, were horrified by that. Like, oh, why do we, you know, is this too much? Or, you know, we're militarizing this and militarizing that. But now it seems like, oh, that's completely flip-flop. At least to Troy's point, it's always conditional. It's like, oh, I need security here because that protects me. But the border is far away. I've got another angle that I need that to be going on potentially, so I don't care about that. So anyway, I find that's very interesting. The same people who all my life have heard are fearful of the military. And you even said earlier, it's such a small percentage of people who have actually worn the uniform nowadays. So it's even like a smaller and smaller cadre, for lack of a better term, and such a greater strata between the military and the normal civilian population. That's what I find very, very interesting, is like, oh, this is cool now. It's cool to have X amount of troops in DC now, where in a different time or different leadership, potentially that would be seen as fascist or whatever.
So. Right. You know, it is a shifting cultural point, right? It's like a moving target. And many of us who have been overseas, to your point, Troy, have watched other capitals or nations, take the nation of Israel, who are largely under arms, or, you know, with arms prevalent in their everyday activities. And the hope has always been the bastion of liberty, where we forged a constitution that preferred the rights of the individual over sort of the collective in a way that also protected the collective. The hope is that that type of a liberty or an environment would be free while also being safe. And that's the mission of the Department of Defense, really, to ensure that the enemies, foreign and domestic, are kept at bay so that our kids and our family members, my daughters, my wife, can live a life here without the interruptions of the state, the security of the state. And what I think we want to be careful of is how much we invest or welcome the state into the spaces that were previously left to the sort of the communities. But that's hard to do when there's a sort of a knee-jerk reaction to preach fear all the time. And, you know, it's been a sort of a common thread. News, we all know the old cliche, right? If it bleeds, it leads. And so it's a more, let's call it business focused operation to talk about those dangers and those threats and those fears, And of course, you can raise money on that. You can bring legislation to bear on that. And so again, if we don't train our constituents, our students, our kids, our family members, how to sort of articulate the other, and the other is the harder, liberty is harder, liberty is hard to preserve. If we don't articulate those messages, we ought to be confident that we'll lose liberties along the way. That's been the nature of the course of humanity.
Yeah, I mean, the one thing that keeps things in check is the three, what we used to have is the three parts of government, right? Checks and balances. And what we've seen since really 2008 and beyond is major parts of Congress, pretty much Congress went lockstep with whatever the executive branch wanted, right? And we saw a courts sided that way, and we lost that checks and balances. And we've seen some legislation in the last couple of, both in the Trump administration and there's some stuff being proposed now that has true bipartisan support, where even today, right, we have four or five very liberal senators on the steps of the Supreme Court calling to, you know, pretty much wipe out one arm of the checks and balances of the Supreme Court by stacking four more justices in there and getting rid of the filibuster, just pretty much wiping out any opposition voice. You have that happening, but you also, according to reports, you have Nancy Pelosi and others saying there's no way they're going to let that through. I was very reassured when I saw that. Like, if that's true and they hold fast to that, it's like, good. I'm glad to see people not just walk in the party line and just nod at their, you know, north and south and just say we're all going this way. That there may be some smidgen of just, hey, we're going to do what's right for the country regardless of what the letter is after that person's name proposing something. So I look at that, and then I look at what I lately have been calling the fourth arm of the government, and it's media, right? I look at not just big media, in all reality, the major networks and all that aren't the media. It's Silicon Valley is the media, right? It is big tech, because that's where everyone goes. People, it is common now that people don't even get cable. They get a YouTube TV and they Hulu and Netflix, and they stream everything. So the big tech pushing the narrative they want to push, along with mainstream media, in my opinion, has become the fourth arm of the government, because they are absolutely the ones that are swaying our elected officials' thoughts and motivations on what they do. It's not the constituents back at their home offices. And that part really scares the crap out of me.
Right. Yeah, that's a great,
I know I did a lot. I threw a lot there. I know there's a lot to unpack.
No, you know, the truth is, again, we go back to where the founders started, and in principle, they'd hoped to suppress what was an old world system where, large families and, oligarchs and others with, significant amounts of sort of, compressed, if you will, power were effectively managed in a sort of a full governance way. In other words, the checks and balances were built such that the initial instinct is those kind of things could be kept level. Where we've gone has been a little different. You talked first and foremost about administrative sort of function, the function of the administrations, and over 100 years or more, you know, these are big stories. I got to see them up close. How does an administration operate? And part of what you're talking about is kind of the where the power actually resides, how the chief executive as a president rules and governs. How does Congress check that? How does the Senate weigh in, or the judicial branch? And a lot of things have happened in the last 50 years in particular to attempt to legislate, let's call them guardrails, the sunshine laws that govern how the administrative procedures acts occur. How does the boss get his ideas across the table? Who pays the money for it? And a lot of those boil down into the competition between the executive branch and the other branches. And in some ways, the executive branch has consistently kind of grown more effective power. Things like Office of Management and Budget, that basically says, you know, if you're not within the budget, your rule is going to run up against my obstacle. So the White House sort of weighing in on keeping control. Then you get to the Senate and the House, and here's a group of people who, for all the right reasons, try to avoid responsibility the same way you and I try to duck around on the battlefield. Like, we're not trying to be standing up when the rounds are coming our way. We get a lot of congressmen and senators who are very comfortable, for example, avoiding the War Powers Act and passing their responsibility into a thing like the AUMF, the Authorized Use of Military Force, passed in 2001 and sort of added to and taken away from over the years and stretched out to go from a hunt in Afghanistan to Horn of Africa to North Africa to Trans-Sahel to Indonesia, right? And so this is an example of how we're watching the powers, the three branches, kind of compete for power, but then back away from the responsibilities that attend power. That's what our founders were hoping, is when you take a vote to send our treasure, sons and daughters, to war, that vote can hurt you. But here we are again, 20 years later, having, you know, the first president in, I think, four now, Obama twice and Trump and then Bush, having said, hey, we're gonna pull out. Now, it's a controversial decision. That put a lot of people on the wrong side or on different sides of an issue that they didn't know. So when you talk about how do we control, how do we check, or what, how do we even envision that? You know, I think it's very important for us as a people to remember big tech, the moneyed influence in Washington, D.C., all of those have an effect, namely because some of us, frankly, have not been good. We haven't been watching the hen house as much.
Yeah.
And as the legislators have stolen power or reasserted power or ducked power, if we aren't holding them accountable, we can assure ourselves that we'll lose our voice. So where we are in America today is we ought to be reassessing this. Forums like yours ought to be challenging our citizens, our constituents. How do we assert our voice? And where that is lawful, moral, and ethical, it should always be championed. Where it violates ethics and morality, it should always be guarded or protected against, right? So it's a very complex thing, but I will suggest that one of the things that we know historically is this is kind of the norm when a governing power becomes deals with the consequences of peace, right? The liberties that we have fought for and earned have given us the blessings of peace. So that, you know, we're two car families and, you know, three TV families, and we've got a lot going on in our lives, and the founders knew that. So they had hoped that while we were busy, you know, raising our families, building farms, building businesses, we would trust our legislators because we felt like they came from us.
Right.
So you see a lot of legislators that get lost in Washington, D.C. They haven't seen their districts in a year. They don't know the people. They don't know the price of the groceries. So they're not really able to kind of distill our voice if we leave them in there too long. We need rescue missions. We need a SWAT team, a SEAL team, or a Delta Force team or something to go in there and get some of those politicians out of D.C., send them back home so we can refresh and make sure that we're being represented well. Otherwise, you've seen it. These guys aren't leaving town,
right?
Not by hook or crook.
So just to clarify, you're talking about term limits and not a tactical team doing any kind of violence of action. So make sure everyone's watching.
Yeah, I'm not even talking term limits as much as the voice of the constituent, right? You've got the power to take these guys back home through the vote. The fact that we've got 40-year senators and congressmen, it's not very healthy for us. So we just need to look at that as people and go, are we comfortable with this, or do we want to make a change? And the only way we're going to make that is if folks like you are on the leading edge of the articulation of this type of idea.
Well, you know, I've always said, if the leader of this country, if the president of the United States is limited to two terms, why shouldn't anyone else be, right? If that person is limited, everyone else should be limited to two or a max of three, because of different size terms, right, to go back. So they are, you know, we have a rash of young congresspeople coming into office now that just came into office on this latest election, mostly Republican, young Republicans coming in, fresh voices, and a lot of that stems from the last 12 years, where the American people were saying in 2008, hey, we want somebody from outside of Washington. That's the reason why Obama got in office. It wasn't because of it. It was just because he, even though he was in politics, he was so new, so young into politics. He did not look like your stereotypical old white-haired politician that everyone else has always seen on the TV. And he looked like a fresh face. And they said, let's give him a chance, right? His whole thing was hope and change, right? And I've talked about it here before. The reason why Trump won, and the reason why Bernie almost won in 2000, 12 was because of the American people said, apparently you weren't hearing us. We really want somebody from outside of DC. Right. And had the DNC not helped out Hillary and truly stole it from Bernie, it would have been Bernie against Trump. And even though Bernie's a senator, he's so out there on the edge, no one even really considers him a normal politician.
Right.
You see that, but then you talk about the power of the vote, but I keep looking at this, what I call the fourth arm of the government and the narrative. And I'll spin this back to an event that happened just, I think, 4 months ago, right? Nancy Pelosi calls General Milley, right, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and says, don't worry about what the Constitution says. Don't let any soldiers deploy. Don't let anyone do anything unless I approve it. Don't listen to to President Trump because we think he's not mentally stable. And how about you just listen to me and I'll control and let Congress decide if we need to deploy troops or not. That was freaking major. And talking with mutual friends of ours, Jason, and we were talking in circles. My head was blown. Like, oh my God, this is it. She stepped way over the line, and it was a blip. You didn't hear anything about it. It's like you're talking about the number three in the power in the chain of succession, calling the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, the top military officer, the top uniformed person in our country, and saying, let's violate the Constitution, and I will take and you will not take orders from the chief executive, the commander chief, on deploying or pushing missiles or whatever. You're going to listen to me. And this country didn't give a crap because the media didn't tell them about it and tell them they should care about it.
That's a heavy case to lay down, and it takes us right back to kind of fundamentals, right? The chief building block of a society is the family, first and foremost, right? The institution of the family, when strong, governs within itself first before we project our children out to become citizens and apply their talents in the world. When the family structure, as it is now, is competing along a spectrum or a range of like overwhelming sort of information, overload, information, stovepipe, information, blackout, they're really busy living their lives. And it's going to be very difficult to kind of pull them out of the daily, you know, everyday workload and watching the kids and taking them to schools and different projects and keeping up, you know, with the Joneses, so to speak, to get them to invest in what are really policy-oriented discussions inside the Beltway. So once again, we have that distinction. The founders knew this. This is what the great Cincinnatus of Rome said, right? We ought to be able to go from politicians back to farmers. We ought to be able to take ourselves back out of D.C. and into the heartland to know what our people are doing, feeling, thinking, and seeing. And because we've lost a little bit of that, our families have a little bit of a distinction or a separation between kind of high fidelity of what's happening in the administrations and how to get to that fidelity, because it's very complex. Our legislative laws now are long. The omnibus bill has changed the way legislation is done so that, you know, instead of kind of arguing the merits of a bill every session, every quarter, and moving that bill along from committee to committee, everything rolls up under an omnibus. And for 10, 12 years now, by again, ducking responsibility, Congress and the Senate are passing legislation that isn't really being debated. And so even if the people were, let's say, able to kind of get to the merits or the fidelity of what's happening in our halls or Capitol Hill, they would have a difficult time kind of getting through these 3,000 and 6,000 page omnibus things and divining what the best sort of legislation is. So we had a lot of problems there. We just stacked a whole lot. How do we burn through that? That's the tough question. And in the real case is, you said it, you made a beautiful case that the spirit of the American constituent is still alive. It's thriving. We said Obama, because we think he's different and he's going to bring some new things to the table. We said Trump, he's different. You talked about Bernie Sanders, he's different. You can hear the people saying the same thing over and over again. Let's get some different folks in there, try to shake it up, change things, because we don't think our voice is really well heard. So I would just encourage the folks out there who've been disappointed. Maybe their candidate didn't make it. Maybe they were Bernie fans. Maybe they were Hillary. Maybe they were whatever, Biden or Obama or Trump. Whatever your stripe, wherever your background is, we have the right as American citizens to ask for change, to bring people into this dialogue that will represent us. But we have the responsibility to fire them in a heartbeat when they're not living up to our standards. So as the old saying goes, throw the bums out, you know, and if we can't do that, we gotta expect that the cottage industry of politics is not going to take our voice seriously. It's a cottage industry because you can do it all day long, your entire life, and never right. do anything else and make a ton of money. Remember when Anthony Weiner said that, I don't know what else to do. I've got to run for office. There's a guy that his skill, which is a talent, and it's a valuable skill, but that's all he knew. So it's our job. It's our voice that if we don't get folks standing up, taking a sword or an axe to these sort of legislative pieces and cutting them apart and showing them or helping us dialogue them, we got to count on what we have now, which is momentum. So again, I'm going to encourage people this. The hope is when you get to a primary, that's your shot. You know, right after the primary, everything gets locked in stone and you've got kind of the two, you know, titan candidates going against each other. But before the primary, you've got a chance to weigh in and do something different. So if you've been voting in your November elections on the election years, it's time to step back and go, how do we get the right kind of candidates? Take a chance. You're not going to do worse than we are. Right? You're not going to find politicians that are going to fail you in bigger ways than what we've seen in the last 50 years. We've seen some big failures. So take a chance with someone who brings new ideas to the table, and then you've got to back them. And how do you back a politician? Everybody knows that answer. It takes money. So if we don't put our money behind the kind of people that we want to see in DC, and I don't really care what political background you are, you've got to put some checks in some people's pockets. And if it's the same guy that's been there, same girl that's been there 20, 30, 40 years, they're not going to hear from you. So
right.
It's we the people either force the change through the moneyed system and bringing new voices to the table, or we got to deal with the same cards we've been dealt.
But can we the people fight against the super PACs and those that have unlimited limits and can bring stuff? I mean that's one thing.
Yeah.
And number one, number two, I know, Doug, I keep saying I'm going to go to you, but I keep getting pulled. Number two, you said we American citizens, but the reality is now it's not even have to be American citizen. You just got to be sitting inside this country, right? And for in a lot of states, get away with voting however you want without even being legally supposed to be able to vote.
Okay, great questions. Let me break some hearts here. Super PACs, all they are is institutions that are there to carry a voice into the dialogue. So you're out there, somebody out there is listening right now, and you have something that is meaningful to you. I don't know what that is. Solar energy, electric cars. I don't know. I don't care. Start a super PAC, bring some money to the table, advocate for your voice, and start sponsoring candidates. You can do that, right? A super PAC really is the old institution of the public square. It's gathering your friends who believe in your cause and pouring together that energy, which translates into money, or money translates into energy, and going after the support systems you like. If you want laws passed in your state, start a super PAC. Start building energy around what you're doing. So everybody likes to demonize the money inside politics, but I've got a real unfortunate story to tell here. All politics is shifting money. When Congress meets, there's only one thing they're doing, which is asking for your money to spend on an issue, right? So if you're not good at asking for money, you're not ready for politics. So politics is taking money from my pocket and putting it against an issue that somebody believes in, right? So the super PAC is a sort of a training cycle for that type of mentality. And while people kind of fear it, remember it's an IRS institution. This is blessed off by your government. So when you want to get involved, and let's say your number one issue is protecting baseball caps with, you know, a snapback sort of closing, well, start that super PAC and get money around it, start advertising, start advocating for that inside your communities. And if you're not the guy to lead it, then find the ones that are standing up for your cause and support them. That's the key right there, because that's how super PACs fight super PACs, right? It's all media. You've got to wage the sort of the information operations inside the media streamlines, canisters, pipelines, whatever. It's not easy, Yeah. I'm not here to pretend that this is easy. But I think the first thing is, if we take the scales off the eye, we don't become fearful.
Right.
What packs are doing. Right. It's the same thing with C3s and C4s. And for those who don't know, the big funding, the big mechanisms, the big money flows through charity organizations and foundations. So when you see something happening in your local environment, a news story pops off, there's a pretty good chance that somebody's got a C3 or C4 that's paying for sponsoring or uplifting advocates. That could be folks that are hosting a I don't want to use the word riot, but some sort of an event.
A gathering.
There could be signs. It could be fueled.
Mostly people.
Yeah. Mostly it's the people. Grassroots, the astroturfing that people have been talking about. That stuff is business. It's big business. And if we're not comfortable with big business, put the rosy glasses on and go home, because this isn't for you. DC is about big business. It's war in politics. And if you've got an issue, you've got to be ready to fight for it.
Is it key? You mentioned local, you mentioned communities, and I've been saying this a lot, right? People should be starting local, right? People worry about the presidential election, but isn't there more? And we saw it in this last election when states and local communities made the rules that govern the ballot boxes and how that stuff. Shouldn't people get really start at the local level? Assembly people, school boards, mayors, that kind of stuff. Shouldn't they really start there versus trying to go for the Super Bowl and go and try to influence and impact, normal everyday people that don't have, George Soros money, that's like, what could they influence? Shouldn't it really start at the local level and see if they get a taste for it? Would you recommend that?
Yeah, I mean, that's a really, that's a question that has a lot of supporting elements and derivatives. Let me start by suggesting that the model in history suggests the other, right? Leadership, leadership, leadership. Leadership is extremely important for culture, for war, for politics, for national vision, for anything that requires a lot of movement. It's very important to understand how leadership impacts that. And if you're a fan of the scriptures, I am, you read the Bible from the opening line to the final clause, what it recommends is leadership is where change happens. So if you take the ancient nation of Israel, throughout the period of the judges and the kings, you'll see a template that I think we have to be careful of not blowing past too quickly, which is when a leader is good, the nation benefits. When a leader is bad, the nation suffers. And yep. So it is not to say that we ought not impact our local communities, but we have to be aware of the old statement. I can't remember who said it first, but politics is downstream from culture, right? And if our culture is sort of, let's say, headed towards, 33 degrees on the compass, well, politics is going to be in that direction too. If on the other hand, the culture is, headed towards 183 degrees, well, the politics kind of follows that too. So where leadership impacts is by influencing culture, which is why men like Winston Churchill or, men like, say, Roosevelt could stand up, or John F. Kennedy could stand up at the beginning of a decade and say, we're going to get to the moon. This is a mark of leadership, and it happens because a nation is congealed behind a sort of a focal point of that energy. So I'm very cautious about how much, I carefully guard myself from expecting too much from action that happens at the grassroots level to influence the national level, only because, again, I'm a fan of the scriptures and I see the model. That's a tough
one. Great point. That's a great point, Jason. If I could, Troy, I wanted to shift gears.
Yeah.
Maybe, I don't know if it's slightly or radically. I know we talked earlier about, the conditional caring, sort of selective outrage back when, troops were in the airport versus what's going on in D.C. now. What's your opinion, Jason, on, the president's announcement, a day or two ago about withdrawing troops from Afghanistan? And before I let you answer that, I just want to throw out that to me, it's the same thing whenever it was Trump pulled out the couple dozen SF dudes out of Syria, you would have thought that he was like just got on the phone and unconditionally surrendered to, you know, China, Russia, and then whatever, you know, Iran, whatever, North Korea, whoever threatens us from some of that crowd, you know, whether it was retired generals or whatever. I haven't heard anything about, you know, if we do that, you know, what happens. So I'm just curious in your opinion on not only the actual action itself, and then I would say the lack of reaction to it.
Yeah, great. Both two prongs of a really great conversation. Number one, a couple weeks ago at the Association of the United States Navy, we signed onto a letter calling for the withdrawal that Trump initially established for May 1st. So we were one of several VSOs that said, hey, look, it's time. And you never quite get it right. When you're with a coalition, you don't always get to say everything you want. What we really wanted to protect for our service members is the idea that if we're going to continue to deploy, the mission should be clear, and mothers and fathers should know exactly what their sons and daughters are signing up for and why their treasure is worth the threat. What we saw with Biden, which was phenomenal, is that, you know, he says, I think he said something like, I'm now the fourth president to preside over American troop presence in Afghanistan. And then he reflects that two Republicans and two Democrats were there before him. And I love what he said, which is, I will not pass that responsibility on to a fifth. Now, what is fascinating about that is what you said, Doug, which is that although the military pushed back on that, and those in the leadership levels at the DOD and others have got a problem with that, we didn't really hear it much, and we didn't really hear the pushback. And one ought to be pretty skeptical about why we didn't hear that, or why the conditions were different as opposed to what we heard, as you point out, in Syria, or when the President Trump at the time sort of initiated what he wanted, which was a withdrawal. We heard the pushback then, which meant somebody was amplifying that voice. Somebody was amplifying it for a reason. And now, same statement, no voice is amplified. So that ought to serve as a caution to those of us who are sort of in observation mode. We don't vote. Well, we vote, but we don't get a vote as far as the president's orders. And we ought to be aware that that sort of change, that sort of ironic reversal of that amplification ought to set us on sort of the warning or cautionary mode. If this voice is sort of changing every time a different person says the same thing, we ought to be skeptical of that voice. So here comes the next heartbreaker. We ought to be treating our media in the same manner that we treat our politicians. We don't start out with trust. We don't start out with a blind sort of loyalty, and we don't start out with the open kimono sort of everything you say I take for face value. We have to vet them in the same manner we vet our politicians. And if we're not doing that, if we're still supporting those who challenge the truth or cannot be neutral observers, then we again are going to be at fault. We're going to get bad information from them. So I love that we finally get to a place where a president says, here's a really reasonable statement. If we don't know why we're in Afghanistan, let's not continue to put our men and women in harm's way. And in this case, nobody caused a fuss. So we should be thankful for that. But then we also have to be careful that we hold the media accountable for why is that now different than it was before.
Right.
And then make sure that we put them in a real tight box of scrutiny and make sure that the next thing they say, we don't take for face value.
Right. No, that's exactly right. Because, you know, I almost think that I told my wife that, you know, when he said that on the 20th anniversary, but I could see Trump saying that. I could see it's almost like Trump put a memo out, you know, maybe last fall or even earlier. And that, you know, so, you know, it just it, somebody in the DOD maybe just, oh yeah, we'll just hold this. I won't pass this forward. And then it's almost like, you know, I can almost see like, oh, I'll read that. You know, you hand it to the current president. Oh, okay. Because, but again, it's just the conditional, you know, the conditions under which the same message,
yes.
But the messenger is different. So therefore the reaction is.
Yeah. And look, this one I saw up close and personal. I was in the Department of Defense when the acting defense secretary, Chris Miller, was asked the same thing, to carry this message forward, which is what President Trump at the time had asked for, was a withdrawal down to sort of certain levels that are pretty much zeroed out except for special operations. The reaction in the Beltway with the senior leadership was very hostile, meaning everybody pushed back on that. And that's in the President Trump's former administration. A lot of people have a lot of investments and emotional investments otherwise right. in the continuation of these things. What we saw was the voices were so overwhelming and then amplified that the president at the time, for whatever reason, you'd have to ask him, he'd have to be in the room, wasn't able to drive that voice home. Now we see, again, senior leadership pushing back on President Biden, and Biden's statement was very clear. You know, I'm not passing this one on. So for whatever reason, this is where people, I think, ought to celebrate that sometimes the executive branch has got to show the force of personality to enforce an idea, whether you like the president or not, right. ought to be secondary to the policy. And if you like the policy, it really shouldn't matter who says it, as much as that might hurt you inside. So in this case, I think the American people have a chance to reflect. What do you want? Do you want the person, or do you want the policy? And for my money, I'll take the policy all day long, because that's the one I've got to look the eye under.
Yeah, absolutely. It's interesting to say. I mean, I was on air today with Dave Bellavia on WBEN, and we were talking about this, and you know, Dave asked me about it, having been to Afghanistan myself, and as a contractor and a soldier. And I told him then, I said in 2007, we need to pull out. We're done, right? This country needs to step up and take this and handle this themselves. And we've been marching soldiers, our treasure, sons and daughters, in as cannon fodder, right? Since that time, without a clear plan, right? We all know that, you know, as a military, you give us an objective, we take it, we seize it, we move on. And eventually we kill enough enemy or destroy enough infrastructure, the enemy gives up, says, I've had enough, right? World War II is a classic example. But with this one, we haven't done it. And he asked me about comparisons between this and Vietnam. And I said, there are a lot of comparisons. Because like in Vietnam, we did not take and hold ground. We did not march toward an objective. We kept letting it go. And a lot of vets of Vietnam, you know, wondered, you know, and obviously we know about a lot of that happened afterwards. And people wondered, you know, they were told they lost, they did this. We know a lot of these vets, my dad included, won battles and made a difference. When I was in Afghanistan, I won battles and made a difference. But at the end of the day, when I look at this from the macro level, what did we accomplish by marching our soldiers into there without giving them a clear objective and clear mission? They killed some bad dudes. We lost some really good people. But at the end, we gave that FOB up. We gave that outpost up, whatever it is, without a clear objective. That's why I said we need to be out in 2007. So I'm good with the policy, you know, the decision to pull out. I'm not good with announcing it and making it look like a photo op. A photo op that I compared that the left accused President Trump of doing when he wanted to have a July 4th parade and have the big thing. And the people are like, oh, he's using our military as a prop and a gimmick, right? He could have picked any day, but to say on the 20th anniversary of when this country was attacked and say by that time, right? We only have, I think, rough now, Jason, you could correct me. We're sitting at about 2,500, 5,000 troops max. I think we're closer to 2,500 in Afghanistan, right? Between military and contractors.
Right.
There's not a lot there. You could slowly roll them out and then say, hey, by the way, we're out, and not right. make it look like September 11th, right? That's the yeah. day. Because it just reeks. For two reasons. One, that date reeks of it's a big look at me anniversary kind of thing, number one. Number two, President Biden is known through his 47 plus years in Congress to be wrong pretty much 100% of the time on foreign policy, right? This is a guy that wanted to take Iraq after we knocked Saddam out and split it up into three countries and give each one of the Sunni, Shia, and Kurds. He thought that was the best plan, right? He also thought he was the sole voice in the Obama administration that didn't want to execute the bin Laden raid. Sole senior voice. The guy has been wrong 100%. So when he comes out with a policy, even though we know, I think we could all agree, it's probably not him, it's his handlers that are telling him what to say. But, I mean, he's been wrong so many times, I have a hard time thinking it's going to be for the best if it's a decision he makes.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Go ahead, Doug.
No, I'm sorry. I was just going to say, too, you know, when Jason, you said, you know, you quoted the president saying, oh, it's been two administrations, two Republicans. He conveniently left out he was vice president for two of those terms, eight of those years, and a senator for all those years. And since he was elected to the U.S. Senate in November of 1972, when Richard Milhouse Nixon was president, just to put a historical marker on how long he's been at the federal level. And I think he was something else before that. So probably my whole lifetime he's been a politician. But anyway,
well, I'm going to do a little tactical pivot here, and I'm going to go back to what Troy said in the beginning. And I love, Troy, that you and others, Doug, I think yourself as well, but have had this on the ground experience. And we know as frontline service members kind of what it looks like. And I think it occurred to all of us at some point in our deployments in the recent 20 years that this wasn't happening. This being, you know, the great, grand, strategic, beautiful picture that we were going to end at. There was no real goal. And so a lot of us who bore the battle, if you will, as Lincoln said, kind of understood that. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to say, look, I'm going to give our politicians a little bit of grace here, mostly because if I go to a used car lot, I'm pretty sure they're going to try to sting me on the price, right? They're used car salesmen, not to berate them. You know, if I go to a church, I'm going to get sold on the gospel. You know, if I go to a Buddhist, you know, he's going to teach me about Buddhism. If I go to a politician, I kind of know what I'm going to get. Here's what I'll pivot to. Guys and girls, if you've been out on the ground and you have experience and you've seen the things you've seen, it's time for us to assert our leadership in this nation. It's time to take the 1% or 2% that have served in uniform and make sure that you're taking a run at Congress, or you're taking a run even at your local level that we talked a little bit about before. And I don't mean to poo-poo that. If we're not involved and we don't roll those experiences from Vietnam forward into leadership, or from Afghanistan and Iraq into leadership, and we're seeing some veterans that are running for these things, then we can assure ourselves that politicians will continually do what they do, which is sell us kind of on the grand vision and never really deliver, right? We need folks that understand operational delivery to be inside this debate, and they've got to be strong voices. So I'm going to encourage folks that are listening that have been burned on this, or felt like they didn't have their voice heard, or that they saw something like, okay, it's time now. You had the uniform and you checked the first block, which was you stood up and swore the oath, you defended and you protected. Great job. But that's just step one. Step two is you got to come back to my civic battlefield and you've got to fight the civic battle alongside me. We may not agree. You might have different policies, but I still want you in that civic fight. And if that means you're at school board meetings, or if you're the guy that is whipping the vote in your district, or walking the ground doing door knocking campaigns, or getting involved in phone banking, I really don't care. If you're a part of a veteran service organization, make your voice heard. And that doesn't mean rubber stamping legislation that somewhere in the legislation has the word veteran. That's not enough, because your politicians are going to trick you. They're going to deceive you. I don't want anybody to be deceived by that. If you're trusting your politicians, you're in the wrong country. In America, we don't trust our politicians. We support them when they're right, but we scrutinize them when they're wrong. And the only way we do that is if we get involved. And veterans, if you're out there hearing me, we can't afford to stop and hang up the uniform. Yeah, you can hang up your actual BDUs or ACUs or whatever, but you can't hang it up mentally. Guys are coming back, girls are coming back, they're checking out. We've got high suicide rates. Mental health is important. Well, one of the major things we found in the VA and really other places, and I think you know this, is if we don't have a mission in front of us, we're likely to kind of peter out and sort of find ourselves on plateaus. So what's the mission? It's Mission America. It's how to save and preserve the Republic for your sons, your daughters, your wives, your husbands, whatever you've got in your life. If we don't do it, I'll make you this commitment, this promise. If we don't do it, it will be lost. Okay.
No, so one will.
That's right.
Jason, when are you running for office? Let me know.
I was just going to say, that was it right there. I'm sold. I think you sold me.
Well, I haven't sold my soul yet, so so I'm not really there. I want to lead great veterans into the fight, and I hope that we can motivate this generation to get in front of this thing, because the Republic is fragile.
It is. It's an experiment that is still ongoing, 200 plus years, and we haven't perfected it, as we see, because it's an ever-moving target. And just like the battlefield where the enemy gets a vote, in this country, there's a lot of different folks getting votes, and I don't just mean in the ballot box. I mean in all levels of influence, right? Media, tech,
right.
Yep. Whatever it may be, just national policy decisions and actions all are adjusting it, right? You know, I say that I'm speaking of, you know, riots in cities and violence, gang violence, and you know, violence within communities or violence with law enforcement and official. It doesn't matter. All of that is our votes that affect what this country, which direction this country is pointing, right? And
that's it.
Yeah. So
well, that's again why veteran service organizations look. They're not perfect. That's the warning shot. You can't just jump in and put a veteran label on something and it's grand. We need involvement. I represent a certain group, but we want more engagement. Folks that are out there that are worried about policies or laws or legislation, they've got little focal points. Throw in with a crowd that is representing you. If I represent you, join me, come into AUSN and let me take your voice to the Secretary of Defense, Navy, Veterans Affairs, the White House. If someone else does, let them do it, right? There's other great organizations out there. But that's the point. You don't personally have to do all the work, but we need to be collegiate. We need to be team-oriented, and we need to find leaders that actually can move the needle for us.
Yeah, absolutely. Awesome. Awesome. Great stuff. Hey, we've covered a lot of stuff, and we've been running an hour 15 already. It is.
Now, can you believe it? Jason, I recommend you have, I mean, Troy, have Jason on again, because we didn't even get to, like, VA stuff or, you know, maybe a little bit more about AUSN and stuff. So definitely, I think you should have him back.
Yeah, definitely. We'd love to have you. But I want to give you an opportunity, Jason, to highlight anything that is near and dear to your heart, anything that, that you know, you just want to highlight for our listeners and viewers, or just emphasize that if there's anything like that, I want to give you an opportunity to make sure we don't skip past that.
Thank you. No, I appreciate that. Look, I'll ask you to come alongside, you know, if you like what I've said, join me. I'm at, the AUSN, the Association of United States Navy. Find us on Twitter at AUSN Tweets, and help me take your voice into DC. But I want to talk about something else that's near to me real quick, because I met these guys along the way and they're doing a fantastic thing. It's another 501c3. And one of our real, I think, critical gaps is what I'll call the sort of the human trafficking morality issue, right? And guys that are on the front lines of that, to me, are right. They're right in the heart of what we expect from veterans, right? Leading in places that are hard, morally hard, ethically challenging, and that debase the foundation of America. These guys are over at deliverfund.org, deliverfund.org. And they're trying to stand up what is essentially what we did, Troy and Doug, downrange. So the information operations, the backside intelligence gambit, and how to go after trafficking that is compromising our sons and daughters in the streets of America. And they've got some great statistics. Well, when I say great, I mean they should worry us of how bad that situation is. And every time I see something like that, it breaks my heart. We're the greatest country in the history of the world. And if we can't protect our young children from trafficking or things like that, that's a big fail for us. And guys and girls that are invested in the health of our country should be involved. Again, cut the check or do whatever. I don't work for those guys. I don't make a nickel off it. But what I know is that when you get folks that are doing hard work like that, the rest of us ought to be supporting them. So other than that, I just say, look, get involved. Find someone you like. If you like what you hear from me, okay, come along. Correct me, watch me, scrutinize me. Same thing with your politicians. Find the ones out there that are going to change the dynamic for you. So the biggest thing is we need your voice. We need your leadership. I really appreciate you guys having me on today. I love this country. Let's do everything we can to preserve it.
Oh, absolutely.
Amen, brother.
Yeah.
Great stuff.
That sounds like Deliver Fund sounds like a great organization. It's very similar to one that we support on here, Vets for Child Rescue, that does that, has rescued. It's a great guy, Sawyer, leads that, that has uses a lot of former Tier 1 guys, and they have rescued kids all over the country, actually all over the globe. They do kind of the same thing. They bring those talents and skills that our country has done so great in training them how to do, and they use it to bring our kids back. So that's awesome. So we definitely, Rob, our producer, put up deliverfund.org in the chat, and thank you for letting us know about that. Any more of those organizations, the better, right? That's
yeah, exactly.
Awesome.
Yeah, I'll promote them all if I can, because I love our children.
Yeah. Well, it's awesome, Jason. We will, if everyone doesn't know, we've been talking to Jason Beardsley. He is a retired Green Beret Master Sergeant and very active now at Association United States Navy, and has been very active in the VA and Department of Defense and giving to our country well after the time he hung up his uniform. So hopefully you liked what you heard tonight, and hopefully you got to catch it all. If you don't, go back and listen. All this is archived. You can do it. And Jason, like Doug said, we'd love to have you back on. But there's a lot more. And as I told you before the show started, wasn't sure how it was going to go. We never do. We never get time to get to everything. There's just so much to hit
right.
on. And hopefully we can get another time to have you back on. You enjoyed yourself tonight.
Well, hey, I appreciate it. Listen, I'll give one more shout out. We're getting ready to head to Kentucky next week, and we're going to hit the Bourbon Trail. And if you've got some Marines or some Navy veterans out there, you can email us at the you can email me at jason.beardsley@ausn.org. And if you do and you want to join us, we'd love to meet up with you.
Well, my good buddy Rob Sandry's in the chat. He is a former Marine tanker. He's up in Illinois area, but I don't know. He may want to get himself on a flight down there. And
We'll take you down. We'll do a little tasting and check out some bourbons.
Good deal. Yeah, absolutely. That's one of my bucket lists is to hit that Bourbon Trail and hit them all.
But, hey, let's do it.
But awesome. Well, hey, stay on for a little bit. We're going to wish everyone a good night. Want to thank everyone for joining us and tuning in on this Thursday evening, welcoming us into your homes and into your screens. Be sure and join us next Thursday right here on Stew and the Nunn. Every Thursday, 8 o'clock. Toby should be back with us next week. And hey, you got a month, extra month to file your taxes. They weren't due tonight, thank goodness. And so you got another month to get that done. Be sure and come back and join us. Keep an eye on our chat, like our Facebook page, check out AUSN.org, and check out all our sponsors, everyone that delivers and helps us show out, and especially deliverfund.org too, that Jason brought up. Jason, Doug, thank you guys so much. We'll see you guys later.
God bless. Thank you.
Well, that wraps up another episode of the Stew and the Nunn Show, and we hope you had as much fun listening to it as we did hosting it for you. Don't forget to like our Facebook page and follow us on Twitter. You can find all these links at stewandthenunn.com. We will talk to you again next Thursday at 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Central. Also, we'd like to thank our sponsors, Commodity Outdoors, Veteran Outdoors, Enlist 9 Fight Company, Warrior Media Solutions, and BooHammer.com. Thank you again, and have a good night.